So first of all, let me thank the organizers. It's a pity that we cannot be there and go with a bike as we did last time, and it was very funny and very nice. But still, it's a way to meet some old friends and to discuss a little bit of physics. So this is the title of my talk. And you see here, between parentheses, one part, because I'm pretty sure I will not have the time to go in this part two, but let me tell you what the talk is about. It's about some particular kind of ladder operators and number-like operators, which are related to an SU11 type Lie algebra, and connected with SUSY quantum mechanics and this kind of things, but I will discuss this in details. And if I have time, but I'm not so optimistic, I would say something connected with coherent states which live outside the Hilbert space, or which are defined in a distributional sense. So let me start with the main part of the talk and with some history about what I'm doing. So the point is that when you deal with supersymmetric quantum mechanics, you usually have a factorized Hamiltonian H with in terms of which can be factorized in terms of two operators. If you change the order of the operator, you get another Hamiltonian, the SUSY partner. And the nice aspect between these two operators, relating these two operators, is that if you have an eigenstate of H, you can easily or almost easily find an eigenstate of H SUSY. The idea is very simple. This is the eigenvalue equation for H. And if phi is not in the kernel of this operator A, which is the one used here, then this vector is different from zero and is automatically an eigenvector of H SUSY with the same eigenvalue. So the point is that in this in the standard structure on SUSY QM, the Hamiltonian is taken to be self-adjoint. So it may be interesting to remove this this constraint, and in fact what happens is that you get a richer structure, and this is what my discussion is about. So the interesting thing for me is to have something like this. So I have a non-self-adjoint Hamiltonian, and I will show you that in this way I can produce a lot of other operators, and exactly the ones that you see here, which are connected by the SUSY, let us call symmetry, and the adjoint map, which produce a lot of solvable Hamiltonians, in the sense that I can find eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Another bit of history. In 2018, my paper, my work was motivated by a paper in 2018 by some authors, not only two, several authors, which introduced something like this equation in red, and they call them coupled SUSY. So A and B define a coupled SUSY if they satisfy these two relations, for some delta and gamma related by this inequality. The reason why they call SUSY, I guess, is because the two relations are very much the same, but the order of the operators are exchanged, as you can see here. And they also commented on the fact that even if they look very close to each other, they are different in the sense that, for instance, the first equation can be satisfied and the second is not. And this the one you see here, A and B here, is an example satisfying this but not that. They gave a trivial example, which are bosonic operators. So if you start with bosonic operator, satisfying these commutation rules, and you take delta 1 and gamma minus 1, you can introduce these three operator k here. They satisfy this this algebra here. And more than this, the operators that you see here, but you can check easily, k0 is self-adjoint, and k plus dagger is just k minus, and vice versa. So there is a strong relation, which is...
Sorry, Fabio, can I make a small question?
Yeah, sure.
Why should delta be greater than gamma in this relation?
Because otherwise, of course, you can choose one. You can choose one of the two, but they cannot be equal. This is the point. Because otherwise, it doesn't work.
Okay.
So this is this part here below is the essential part. So you have a this sort of self-adjointness here for k zero and this relation for k plus and k minus. So my interest was, since I am in this community of people working with non-self-adjoint operators, I was trying to, I asked myself if something interesting happens if I lose self-adjointness. So I don't require self-adjointness, I don't want to require or to use self-adjointness at all in this part. And people in the audience know that I usually care about mathematical details. So since, as you can imagine, here the relevant operators involved are unbounded operators, so I have to care about domain of the operators, range of the operators, which is sometimes boring to do. So my preliminary question is a technical one. I was trying to understand if I can construct a star algebra, an algebraic setting for dealing with this operator. Because if I can deal with all these operators in a certain algebra, I can multiply them, I can add them, I can compute the commutators, and everything is perfect. So I don't have to worry about domain, in other words. So this is what I did first, because this algebra exists in the literature. It's called L plus of D. L plus of D is a star algebra of closable operator defined on D, which is a dense subset in a field space, which maps, which contains, yes, this operator, which maps D into D, and the adjoint maps D into D. So this algebra is well studied in the literature, and usually you find a D of this form. So D is, as I mentioned, is a dense domain, and this dense domain is usually constructed like this. So it's the domain of all the powers of an unbounded self-adjoint operator, which is automatically dense in the Hilbert space. So you can introduce a topology in L plus D with its seminoms, and is very much is a very nice settings, algebraic setting. It's like working with B of H, with a set of the bounded operators, but the operators inside this algebra do not need to be bounded. And just the point, as I mentioned before, is that I don't have to care about this quantity here, because if I start with two elements in here, all the relevant operator, which is usually composition of some kind or commutators, they belong to the same algebra. So for instance, if I have bosonic operator, D can be computed explicitly, and is just the set of the test function. And C belongs to L plus of D, C dagger belongs to the same algebra, and the number operator belongs to the same algebra. So everything is perfect. And the same happens for pseudo-bosonic operator, which are operator of this kind. If A and B, at least the easiest situation, which is enough for me, is when A and B are connected with to C, and C dagger for some similarity transformation via some unbounded operator. So In this case, even in this case, L plus of D is enough. So from now on, I will not care about domain because I will work just with this algebra inside this algebra here. So let me define, let me go back to extended, to couple SUSY, and in particular, I introduce actually what I call an extended couple SUSY, which is made by four operators, which are these ones, and two numbers. Again, they satisfy an inequality like this. And I say that these four operators satisfy or define an extended couple SUSY if they satisfy these two equality here, which is similar to the previous one, to this one, to the one in red here, but with four different operators, genuine, really different operators. So the point, once again, I call it SUSY because of the relevance of the position of the operators in the formula. So I can use this four operators to define this family, the K family, K plus, K minus, and K zero, and the super, what I call the super partner, L plus, L minus, and L zero. You see, I call them super partner because of the position here and here. Here, the situation, it doesn't look like the super partner or K zero, but can be written as as something, as some operator written in terms of CD rather than DC because of this condition here. The point is that when I do this, I get twice the same commutation relation that I had before. So you see, I have this and I have that, and they are the same commutation relation, of course. But the point is that K plus is not the adjoint of K minus, K zero is not is not self-adjoint at all, and the same for the L family. So I recover, in a sense, half of what Williams discussed in his paper. But the point of losing self-adjointness is a good point because I can introduce two more families here, P and Q, in this way. They are connected with the K family and with the L family by the adjoint map, which give rise, I repeat, to new operators. And this new family also satisfy this commutation relation. So summarizing, having these four operators here, I get four different families of operators satisfying the commutation relation of these four. So let me consider more in details this kind of commutation relation with this extra condition here. And if I do, if I compute, if I work with this, the first thing to do is to define an operator, which I call its square, even if it's not the square of anything and it's not even positive defined, as we will see in a moment, but this is because the standard notation is this one. This operator is good because it commutes with these three operators. So I can look for common eigenstates of k square and kz, x square and x zero. And to produce common eigenstates of these, I start with one vector, one non-zero vector in D, assuming that it exists. Of course, this is something which I have to check, but in the example I will give you, it exists actually. And this vector has this property. So I start with a single eigenvector of x square and x zero. This is, again, I'm using this notation because this is the standard notation for SU11 that you meet in the textbook when you deal with this algebra. The point, the difference here is that Q0 needs not to be real, for instance, and J as well. It doesn't need to be real and it doesn't need to be positive because I'm losing everything in this operation, in my definition. Nevertheless, what is interesting to me is that if I act with this X plus and minus, I get again eigenstates of x square and x zero, and in particular, I get this equation 7, which tells us that x plus is a raising operator and x minus is a lowering operator. So the structure is similar to what we have in for the harmonic oscillator, but here we have this condition which must be satisfied in both ways, both going up and going down. So this equation 7, in other words, are satisfied if this vector is not in the kernel of one of the two operators. Otherwise, it's just zero, and a zero vector cannot be an eigenvector of any operator. So this is the general strategy, but let us go back to my operator, and I start with the K family. So I'm looking for, I start with a common eigenvector of K square and K zero, and K plus and K minus, as I say, behaves like a raising and a lowering operator, at least if this is not in the kernel, if I'm working with a vector which is not in the kernel of K plus and minus. Because of this relation and because of this ladder equation, I can introduce a family of vectors, so of this vector here. These vectors are all these the vector which I can construct out of a single one, acting on a first one with K plus and K minus. So I get an entire set of vector like this. J does not change. J is related to the eigenvalue of K square, but this is not changed by this ladder operation, while the second quantum number is changed. So I take all these ones, all these vectors here, they are all linearly independent. So they produce and heal the space just by taking the linear span and the closure of the linear span. This Hilbert space, which I call Hj, because J, as I told you, does not change, is fixed in the game, is inside H, is not in the Hilbert space we start with, is some sub-Hilbert space, but is an Hilbert space. This is a crucial point because there is a theorem which tells you that since this is now a basis for this in this Hilbert space, it has a unique bi-orthonormal basis, which I call this way, and which satisfies this equation 10. And the linear span of this is dense in Hilbert space. So I construct a family of vectors which produce a different basis in the same Hilbert space. And this family satisfy this condition that you see here. So this family is automatically an eigenstates of P square, of the second family of operators which I introduced along the way, and is also an eigenstate of P zero. Of course, you must be careful because here you have Q bar, because Q is not necessarily a real quantity. Sorry, here there is a mistake. It's not minus 3 over 16, but it is J times J plus 1. This is a typo. And these vectors here also satisfy this ladder equation. So P plus is a raising operator for this family, and P minus is a lowering operator. Now, there is something which is worth to stress. If you compare this this equation 11 with the general condition 7, you see that here there is no one, no minus one and plus one here, while here you see this. So there is small difference, and this will be more clear when in an explicit example. But the point is that I'm using here two, I'm sort of using a freedom of choice. And this freedom is that while for the first family, for the K family, I'm using the standard approach, which I showed you before, a few slides ago, to introduce these vectors here, I'm using bi-orthonormality. So is nevertheless, I'm not, in other words, I'm not using the same structure, the same properties that I use for K now for P, because P are the adjoint of K, and to me it's more convenient to use bi-orthonormality. Using bi-orthonormality produces something which is slightly different from what I would get using again the same commutation relation. So I can choose what, how to work with this object. But these are details. The general structure that I showed produce a lot of, in Joshua's talk, you can see a lot of intertwining relation. These are intertwining relation between the ladder operators, while 12 are ladder operators between the zero operator, which are what in my mind are in fact non-self-adjoint Hamiltonian. So if you see, for instance, if you concentrate on this equation here, you see that the eigenvalues of K0 and L0 are connected by, but they are different for one, for half integer. In particular, for instance, if you have a vector like this, so you have an eigenvector of K0 with eigenvalue Q, and you act with S on this vector, and when this is not zero, you can easily discover, because of this intertwining relation, that this vector here is an eigenstate of L0 with eigenvalue Q plus 1 half. So go from one spectrum to a different, to some eigenvalue. Remember, the Q changes for units. Going from K0 to L0 changes of half integers. And this is a big difference, which, however, is very observed several times in quantum mechanics. So let me go to an example, to a concrete example of this structure and pseudo bosons. So I have two operators satisfying this commutation relation. And let me be very fast about what I will need in the rest of the talk. For pseudo bosons, I introduce two vacua. Phi zero is a vacuum of A, and psi zero is a vacuum of B dagger. Since in the assumption B is there is stable under the action of this operator, I can work and I can apply to phi zero powers of B and to psi zero powers of A dagger. And I get two families of vectors here. They all belong to D, so they are very nice vector, and they satisfy raising and lowering condition, and they are eigenstates of number-like operators, and they are automatically bi-orthonormal. So there are a lot of properties I discussed several times in these meetings here. It may happen that these are bases or not. More in concrete systems, they are not bases, but they turn out to be G quasi bases in this sense. So this just means that you have resolution of the, they produce resolution of the identity in a weak sense. Okay, so these are the ingredients to construct, pseudo bosons are the ingredient to construct examples of the general structure of my extended coupled SUSY. And the ingredient are these A and B, and they are used in this way. So C and R are SUSY operators, and I take these two coinciding with A, and B and S, and B and S are two other operators of the Susi construction, and they take equal to B. So this is the idea. Delta is 1 and gamma is minus 1. So I can introduce four families, which actually they are collapsed to two, using this definition, 17 and 18, which are not very different from what Williams did in his paper, but with these operators. And again, you see there is no relation between this operator here and K plus and K minus. K plus, in other words, is not the adjoint of K minus and so on. So I can compute everything in this case. The K square operator coincide with the P square operator, and this one, and as you see, is not a positive operator, but it commutes with everything as expected. And then concerning the common eigenstate of K square and K zero, I observed that the vacuum of the pseudo bosonic operator A satisfies this formula. So I have not much time, but this suggests me, together with the other information that I have, this suggests me to put the state, to use this state as the seed vector to construct all the eigenvectors of K square and K zero. And you see there is a difference between the left-hand side and the right-hand side. Here I have just one index. When you see just one index, I'm referring to the pseudo-bosonic operators. When you see two indices, it's because I'm referring to this family here, to this couple of operators. So minus 1/4 actually is always the same, because it's always related to this number here. So it's the solution of this equation, and it does not change in any case. This vector belongs to the curve of K minus, so this means that I cannot go down from this vector, which in other words means that the spectrum of K zero is bounded from below, but I can go up, so I can act with powers of K plus on this vector, and I get a family like this. So the other vectors which I get out of this, I call this way, and you see two things. First of all, that I'm using this notation here. And the reason for that is that if I act with K zero on this vector here, I get an eigenvalue which is n plus 1/4. So the reason why you see this number is because this is exactly the eigenvalue of K zero. The other things that you observe is that all these vectors only contains even numbers here. So these are just the even part of the pseudo bosonic vectors, eigenvectors. You have a rich structure. In particular, K plus moves up and down for one unit. You see minus 1/4, as I told you, is not changed, but the second number changed from 1/4 to 5/4, and K minus goes from 1/4 to minus 3/4. So this is a ladder situation, a typical ladder. And the set of this vector give rise to a linearly independent set which define an Hilbert space. And this Hilbert space, of course, is not the Hilbert space of the original Hilbert space, because it does not contain any vector like this. So a vector like this with the odd index belongs to the Hilbert space, but not to the one I construct in this way. So this is properly contained, as you see here, is properly contained in the original Hilbert space. Still, this set is a basis in the small Hilbert space, in the even Hilbert space, which means that I can introduce a bi-orthonormal family. It has this property, this is bi-orthonormality, And this means that any vector in this Hilbert space can be expanded like this, as usually bi-orthonormal bases do. The basis can be explicitly found in terms of pseudo-bosonic basis, again. So there is this relation. I'm using pseudo-bosonic to construct a vector in a different, in this different realm. And these vectors here, again, are eigenstates of P square, of P zero, and they are moved up and down by the second set of ladder operators. Again, only even number are appear in the game so far. So, what about odd indices? Okay. Odd indexes are easily found when you act not with powers of A and B, but just with A and B. For instance, if you consider this equation here, this this is something which relates a vector of my even Hilbert space into something which is not even anymore. And in fact, I this is the definition that I use. And the reason for using that is, again, that I have this formula here. The n plus 3/4 is just the eigenstate of K0. So I can repeat the same construction very fast. And this construction gives rise to lowering and raising relation. I can introduce a basis for the odd part, a bi-orthonormal basis for the odd part. I can put all together, and this putting all together, I get a basis for the entire Hilbert space, a basis or a quasi-basis, it depends. And this is the operation of putting all together. So, and these are a lot of formula which you don't need to see. The point is, what is not very sufficient in this example, what is poor in this example, is that maybe you notice, I start with four families, and my extended couple Susie is made by four families, but the pseudo bosons give rise to just two families, which is not good, but it can be avoided, we can be generalized, so I can introduce a sort of generalized, again, similarity condition involving two operators. Starting from A, B, and I can define four operators, and they satisfy an extended couple Susie in the real sense. So I have four families, and instead of giving formula, I want to show you this final plot, which to me is interesting, because tells you what is going on. So you have these vertical lines. These are the, we start with these phi tilde vectors, which are eigenvectors of k square and k zero. And you go up and down with the related ladder operator. Then, if you use bi-orthonormality, there is a unique bi-orthonormal family, which you see here in this other vertical line. And these are automatically eigenvectors of p square and p zero. And you go up and down with the ladder operators. Then, if you use the starting operator, so the ones which really define the extended couple Susie, which is which are S, R, C, and D, you define a third family, this one, this key tilde, which are eigenstate automatically of L square and L zero, and you go up and down with this ladder operator. And this is not the end of the story. If you just compute the unique bi-orthonormal family with respect to this, you go here, and these are automatically eigenstates of k square and k zero with this eigenvalue with this ladder operator. Finally, if you have these vectors here, these are connected to this family by the adjoint of this vector. So the structure you see is very rich, very interesting to me, and it contains inside a lot of concrete situations which are quite nice to me. So this is the end of the story, and this is some reference, and in particular reference 3 is the one I had no time to talk about, but who knows, next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Fabio, for your talk. Are there some questions? We have time for one or two questions.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Fabio, greetings. Is it somehow connected to second order or nonlinear supersymmetry?
The operator actually are second order, so are square operator, square of.
Okay, but your squares are not squares. That's something which is very funny structure with negative squares and so on. But there are second order supersymmetry constructions using differential operators, in which there are non-hermeticities connected with this commutation to squares of operators which were called Hamiltonians and closing algebra, I mean closing supersymmetric algebra which is not called nonlinear. Mm-hmm. So it may be, but I don't know how connected.
This I cannot tell you for sure, but it may be. I see more relations with squeezed states and this kind of squeezing operator, so quantum optics. But maybe some system, I can use this technique in connection with second order SUSY. I didn't consider this problem so far.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there another short question?
Yeah, actually, I might have a small question, if I may.
Yes, please.
Hello, Fabio. So I'm just wondering about the motivation of Williams, which you mentioned in the beginning. Was he studying solitons? I mean, the B operator?
He was studying some chemical system.
Yes.
I cannot give you the details, but the paper is motivated, is in a chemical journal system.
Uh-huh. Because the B Degger Hamiltonian that you mentioned at the very beginning, it looks like this when you discuss reflection as potentials, it's related to KdV equation, etc. You want to relate the single bound state, the Hamiltonian with the single bound state to the free Hamiltonian, they are isospectral except for the bound state, then operators like d by dx plus x operating on e to the ikx, they appear there. So yeah, exactly.
Maybe they borrow the example from this literature. The point is that they wanted to show that these two equations here, the one in red, they look very much the same. So a natural question is, but maybe they are really the same equation and you are just playing with us. And the answer is by Williams was no, we are not playing with you because this is a simple example in which this condition is satisfied.
No, I understand. I was just wondering about his motivation.
Maybe, but I don't know really. They don't cite anything in any case. They just give this example.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.